My question today is, will the church forget? I don't think it will forget you unless it should be taken over by the radical liberals of the 60s, who said, in a time when the world was being confronted by an increasingly aggressive and hostile communism, that they stood four square against all anti-communism. Believe it or not, those were Americans. Those were the radical liberals of the 60s. Now, some people think that that went away. It didn't go away. It simply went underground, and today they're still in our universities, but they're tenured, and they are teaching in our schools. The question I would ask today is, will the church forget what you and they and a great many thousands of others fought for, and what some gave the last full measure of devotion to defend? For the principles upon which this nation was founded, of liberty and not license, of godliness and piety and morality, this is what this nation was built upon. Will those things be forgotten? Alas, dear friends, I'm afraid that not only will they, will the church forget them? To a large degree, the church has already forgotten them. Don Wildman, a gentleman who has done an amazing job with the American Family Association, wrote about a decade ago something which I think is even more true today. He says this, quote, "Today, 4,000 innocent, precious lives of unborn babies were snuffed out, and 300,000 pulpits were silent. The networks make a mockery of Christians, the Christian faith, and Christian values with nearly every show they air. Greed, materialism, violence, sexual immorality are standard fare. Program after program, movie after movie contains anti-Christian episodes and propaganda. News articles condescendingly refer to Christians as fundamentalist right-wing, and those who speak out for the sacredness of life are extremists. And 300,000 pulpits are silent." And I would like to turn from this congregation to do something I've never done before. And I would like to speak directly to the thousands of ministers who are watching me right now and say to you, brethren, gentlemen, God needs men who will speak out on the great issues of the day. Martin Luther said, though we be active in the battle, if we're not fighting where the battle is the hottest, we are traitors to the cause. God grant you courage. I've asked people, why do their pastors not speak out? The answer is always the same. They are afraid. Be not afraid. Christ is with you. And I believe your people will support you. Oh, that doesn't mean all of them. I will no doubt get a card or two from some of you complaining about this message. And I want you to know right now, I don't care a flip. The only thing your cards tell me is that you do not understand what the Word of God says. You don't understand what the Word of God is supposed to be accomplishing. You do not understand that you're not only to render unto God what is God's, but you're to render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar's. And you do not understand that our whole culture is going to hell in a handbasket, and most people in the churches are doing nothing about it, and most preachers are very guardedly saying nothing about it. God have mercy upon us. We are literally seeing the end of Western civilization. In most of the major colleges today, there's not a single course on Western civilization. If any mention is made, it would be sloughed off with, oh, you're talking about those dead white men, European white men. Unimportant. A lot of classes on feminism, a lot of classes on homosexual rights, but nothing about Western civilization. You'll get nothing in college about the Christian foundations of this country. If the church doesn't speak out, who will? Growing a nation of pagans. I would like to quote the poem of William Butler Yeats entitled The Second Coming. It's a fairly long poem. I won't quote it to you, but I will quote just two lines because they're so important. It's talking about the second coming. It's talking about slouching towards Gomorrah. It's talking about these times when Western civilization is moving and being pushed more and more and more to the edge of the abyss. And in this time of great conflict, of tremendous issues, the greatest battle in history, what does he say? Quote, says William Yeats, "The best lacked all conviction, while the worst are full of passionate intensity." Now, dear friends, I have been out there all across this country, and I have debated and confronted face to face and eyeball to eyeball the leaders of the abortionist movement, the leaders of the homosexual movement, the leaders of the feminist movement, the atheist, the evolutionist, and all of the left-wing cadre. And I want to tell you something that I've noticed about them. They are all full of passionate intensity. While the best, said Yeats, lack conviction. And I would like to know, which side are you on? Are you here today as one who is filled with passionate intensity for the great cause of Jesus Christ, the only cause worthy of getting excited about? Or are you more interested and get more excited about who's going to win the semifinals in the basketball playoffs? I am saddened to say that with few exceptions, I think that Yeats is right. The best lack all conviction. Ah, dear one, Christ wants you to be a soldier for him. Pray that God will fill you with intensity to do whatever you can to become involved, to get out of the bleachers and onto the field and become a participant in the greatest struggle in the history of the world. A struggle for goodness, a struggle for godliness, a struggle of Christ against Satan. That is the battle that we are in. As one historian said years ago, the reason why Christians are losing this battle is because, unfortunately, so many of the people in the churches don't really believe what they profess to believe. The best of men lack conviction, and the worst are filled with passionate intensity. Where are you? Where am I? May we pray. Father, God, have mercy upon us. God, forgive us for what we have allowed to happen all around us. It is our fault, the fault that lies right here in our pulpits, in our pews, at the doorstep of our churches, that we have maintained a craven silence while the passionately intense, ungodly, immoral, vicious people speak loudly of their rights and privileges. Oh God, make us, we pray, heralds of Christ, and make us courageous to speak out for the truth of thy word against the ills and evils of this day. Oh God, save America, we pray. In thy name, amen.